of these technologies. Okay, so I'll quickly share with few of these slides which are easily available in the data source, and the source is also been given. This has been shown that in globally, what are the fuel sources utilized for electricity production. Initially, we have seen in general the energy production from different sources. These are the sources: the coal, the oil, the natural gas, the nuclear, hydroelectric, all other renewables except the hydroelectricity has been shown over here. This is the global pattern up till 2015, at what share it contributes for electricity generation. So you can see that hydropower, initially it was been high enough. It is the 50 years data, not exactly 50, 45 years, but it shows that the hydropower has been restricted to its value. Nuclear, at some time when the initial portion was been starting up, it has gained much of the popularity, but due to some of its technological loopholes, or I can say there are some problems with it which cannot be tackled. So the catastrophic effect it can happen. So this technology has also been trying to diminish, but recent research again shows that they are going to come up with more advanced technology where they can sustain. Okay, anyways, the natural gas has been going on with its increasing value. Oil is diminishing for electricity production. It is utilized for other parts. Coal is near about maintaining its own share of the structure for electricity production. What is interesting is that these renewables, except the hydro, has also gained its popularity, and it's increasing its share by many fold for electricity generation globally. So the same thing about Indian context, the same 45 years data for Indian context, you see what we are doing is that nearly about 70% of our production has been done with coal. So our electricity has been produced majorly with the coal. Sorry. So our electricity has been majorly produced with the oil, sorry, coal. Oil has gone its diminished contribution. Natural gas is also going in low. Nuclear, as it was starting, it's having the same share itself. No much of advanced as the advanced technology has not been approaching, and so it is going on with the initial production which it has started. No more progress. Hydroelectricity, you can see it is also diminishing, but renewables except hydro, it has going increasing its share. Right from the 2000 onwards, we can see it is going up in much of the high scale. So this is the electricity generation by fuel source in global, the amount up till 2018. So coal is contributing around 10,000 terawatt hour of energy which has been giving, natural gas, hydropower, nuclear, oil, and this is renewables apart from hydro. This is in up till 2018 data, that globally this much amount of power has been, electric power has been produced from different share of fuel. So for Indian context, you can see, so one important thing is that renewables in India is contributing only 0.2 terawatt hour in India, but in globally it is 153. But we need to see that how much portion of electricity is produced by India as compared to the whole of the globe. That is, what is the percentage of India's share of percentage usage of electricity produced throughout in the globe, that we will give you the idea that we are progressing in the renewables or we are in behind. More such reports are available that I will be sharing. But before going to that aspect, let me just see the dark side of the different energy sources. That means, what are the deaths that has been occurring with these energy sources? This is also with the same source by which we have taken. So it is showing you that for per terawatt hour of energy production, what number of deaths have been occurring due to different source. So if you combine the coal, brown coal and coal that is with the different calorific value, if you combine this coal, you can see around 60 deaths per year with per terawatt hour of generation with this coal as a source has been encountered. That means 60 numbers near about. Oil makes a contribution of 18 or somewhat 19 deaths per terawatt hour in a year. Biomass, because what happens is that due to this source, what production has been done, the energy production during this process or during the consumption of that, throughout this whole process, what amount of pollution it gives into air, and due to that, what is the death that has been done. So this is a rigorous analysis and the sourceful data. So we can understand that various sources, by the effect by which it hampers the environment, that is also been seen in environment, exactly the human population in terms of death due to these sources. So you can see this is diminishing as of with the biomass, near about 5 deaths. With gas, it is near about 3 deaths. And with this, the deaths are been reducing with different type of sources. So wind, hydro, solar, these are in this part, and biofuels and nuclear, the deaths has been very low. But one more comparison is that in 2016, the Sovacool et al., they have done one research, they have found it at 0.01, and on 2007, the Wilkinson and others have done their research and they have contributed this value. So there is a redundancy in the value as per the analysis done. Okay, so so with this we can understand that what is the sustainability of a source when they do the production, the energy production, and what effect is that got in human life. Okay, that is human death by which it causes. So we'll see the energy potential, the solar energy potential throughout the globe as well as in India. Okay, so in the global structure, these curves, you can see these values are given, so which are the value in the kilowatt hour per square meter. So with this color codes, you can identify the range where they have got abundance of potential and the low value is been spread with the light colors. Okay, so this is the global structure. If I specifically draw it for find it out for Indian structure, so this is the radiation map with these ranges occurring, the same kilowatt hour per square meter. So this range has been available for different parts of the country. Okay, so for this reason, if I plot the data and if I see this value, that only 1% of land area is sufficient to meet this electricity need till 2031. That means if we harness the solar energy, we only require a small portion, and obviously that small portion will be taken up from the highest irradiance value where it has been projected. That is, it is in the Gujarat range or the Rajasthan range. I think Gujarat range is in this portion and Rajasthan in some portion, and here in the Ladakh portion of India. There are some coastal areas also where there are high penetration of solar radiation. So with this, what we can say is that we can analyze that if we utilize this technology and we can harness this energy, we are sufficient enough to get that amount of power production from solar itself. Okay, this was the sources. So what steps the government has been taking for in respect to the solar energy? There was a National Solar Mission, which was named as the Jawaharlal Nehru National Solar Mission, and it was an initiative by the government of India, central government of India, with the help of the state governments. Okay, so this was one of the 8 key national missions which comprise India's National Action Plan on Climate Change. So there have been, after this, there have been one Paris meeting on climate. There also this mission was been taken up and further modification has been done. So for the mission, what I can say is that initially it was taken up till 20 gigawatt of solar energy production. As you can see from this diagram, this was the initial thought of process when it was been launched on 2008. At that time, they have thought taken up a scale of 14 years, and they thought of that, 12 years ago, they thought of making it 20 gigawatt of the solar power integrated to the grid. Again, this same program which has been launched, it was approved by the government on 11 January, that means 10 years ago. From that time onwards, we can count upon that what we have contributed. So the MNRE, Ministry of New and Renewable Energy, has been the backbone or the background from which they have started with this project. And the main purpose was to promote the solar energy or the solar power for long-term energy security and ecological security. So these two terms, long-term energy security as well as the ecological security, what it means is that we as a country, as a nation, should be self-sufficient or self-reliant with the energy perspective. Because if we depend on the others, as just in the previous few slides I've shown you, we are contributing 70% of electrical energy production through coal, through the source of coal. And this coal is not been only found in India, but we borrow as well as we purchase it from other places where the high calorific coal is been utilized. especially from Australia and other places. So if in some or other day it might happen that India is in bad terms with those countries, then what happens is that the source may be in halt for some time, or it may be in long term. So what we need to do is that we need to have an energy security on our core side, and this source is showing abundant your source availability. Why not harness that and keep it our self-reliant and the only source which we can do so. So this makes the main purpose, and with that purpose it was been started with the 20 gigawatt goal. But in the mid of this decade, from 2010 to 2020, this has been again tuned back into 100 gigawatt, and it has been told that the new 2022 solar mission or the solar goal will be 100 gigawatt. Why is it so from the solar energy? Why is it so? Because by seeing the progress by which it is going through. So what is the progress? This was the progress. It was been done in 2016 and the 17 starting of the time. So it was been seen that up till that time, the progress by which the solar energy has been installed, it has been of great value. That means it can surpass the 2022 target of 20 gigawatt, and we can make some more contribution with the help of solar energy, and that can be enhanced. So this was year on year target. It was been scheduled and at that time by the government. So they have prospected that we will add up with the 100 gigawatt with different sources of different technology of solar energy utilized, and we will add each year with a different values, and we will contribute up till 100 gigawatt up till 2022. So that was the India's vision 2022, and it was been proposed that the power will be contributed to all of them, that means all the population of the Indian national will have the power, and total of 175 gigawatt will be connected to the grid of renewable energy. Out of this 175 gigawatt, 100 gigawatt will be from solar energy, and the rest will be from various other renewable energy sources. This has been reported in the 2017 version of Niti Aayog as per the Niti ambition scenario, this India's vision. So this was the target which I am saying about the 175 gigawatt. 5 gigawatt will be from small hydel projects, that is in the small hilly regions in the Arunachal Pradesh of northeastern side, and in the hilly region of few of the Uttarakhand and this northern belt, and some type of small hydel projects with ranges of in the megawatts or in kilowatts. They will be I don't think so it is in megawatt, it is in kilowatt itself of small hydel projects. So they are being incorporated in localized, and they will be contributing some amount of total 5 gigawatt nation gigawatt of national contribution up till 2022. Biomass, with the help of this, there will be of 10 gigawatt of electricity production, and it will be integrated to the grid. This has been expected. Wind, it is expected that around 60 gigawatt will be contributed up till 2022. And with the help of solar energy, total 100 gigawatt is been expected. Out of this, 40 gigawatt will be from ultra mega park solar projects, which we will see with the help of two of the technologies of solar, that is solar PV and CSP, okay, that will details see that it is later. With 40 gigawatt of PV rooftop solar projects, that is enabling, and it has been in progress, has achieved much of the value. 20 gigawatt from utility scale solar projects. So this distribution has been done, and in all the your parts of this, the three parts of the solar project, they are been in the increasing order. And if you see, this is somewhat old data, but still it shows us the contribution and the encouragement. That means from the solar energy, this orange line is the solar one, each year, particular 1 year, 2013 to 14, 14 to 15, likewise, each year, how much it is contributing to the grid. That means here it was 0.8 gigawatt, which it was been contributing in that year. In the next year, it has contributed additional 1 gigawatt. In the next year, it has given 1.3 gigawatt additional to the grid, and you can see the jump from 16 to 17. It has directly increased in threefold and gone into near about 4 gigawatt addition to the grid. And likewise, in the recent time, it has increased much more higher enough. Okay, so this is India's solar energy contribution to the grid for electricity production, and it is increasing with year on year by that process. So what is India's rise on this global energy scene? That is how the globe is seeing us. So if you see, first I will give one reference from Dr. Fatih Birol. He is the executive director of International Energy Agency, and he has delivered on 14 January 2020 regarding India's contribution. And what he has praised is that India's achievement in its energy sector in recent years have been outstanding. That is, I quote him, that he has said about India's energy production in this way. He also quoted that India is pursuing a very ambitious deployment of renewable energy, notably solar, and has boosted energy efficiency. So in January 2019, actually, one of the team, a team of the senior international agency experts, they visited India to discuss the challenges and opportunities of India's energy sector with government, industry, as well as academia. And they have seen out the whole study, and it was very much encouraging and progressive. So in next year, they have delivered in the open platform and praised India's recent few years, what are their contributions. So what he has tried to say that India's demand for energy is set to double by 2040, and its electricity demand may triplicate. That means what is their expectation by this study is that India's demand by 2040 might go, the electricity demand will go up till three times of what at present it is. Okay, and what he has also told that India's goal include increasing that India's vision, which I have told, that is 155 gigawatt of renewable energy by 2022. So that he has seen that it is promising enough, because as of today, up till 2019 data, it shows that India has nearly produced around 80 gigawatt, and it is the installed capacity which has been running through and connected with the grid. And they also see that what is the long-term requirement that will go up till the 450 gigawatt from renewable energy itself in some near about 2040 inwards. So they have got that hope, and they see that the technologies that are developing and that have been installed, the capacity are going at par. Okay, so technology sources as well as the reforms all are in place, good going with the solar energy as well as few of the other renewables which we have seen. So the final verdict which I can say, which we find from their course, is that in India's renewable rich states, the share of variable renewables in electricity generation is already above 15%. Okay, that means that in countries where we have seen the solar energy potential of various states of the country, we can see that these states or this portion have tried to incorporate the renewable energy and contributed around 15% of their total generation from the renewable energy sources. So that is a good sign of it. Okay, so this I have added for the importance of India's prospect or the India's way by which the globe is seeing, is that what is the renewable energy investment we are doing, that is a percentage of the GDP. So this is old data, because in this source I found it up till 2015, and the recent data which I have got, not got with the source, but I have got the information that it's still in the same range. Okay, India is still going with that same part. That means the percentage of GDP which has been India is contributing, if you can see the global map, it is in the sixth part. That means it is contributing around 0.5% of its GDP for this renewable energy sources. Okay, and highest are with the South Africa and the Chile. They are going with the near about 1.5% of their GDP. That contribution has been going through. So by that way, you can see we are at focusing on that technology, and this gives many options to the entrepreneurs as well as the researchers for investment. Every possibility is there, because the economics behind this renewable energy and the sustainable technology, both has been in analogy. They are going in parallel to parallel. Okay, so this is encouraging in that part. So for any country, if you know that the per capita usage of the energy gives it a boom, that how much is the progress that country has been making. So these data, they are been updated up till 2014 or 15, I think, with these sources. So it shows that from last 50 years, if we say, it has been from 1971 onwards, it has been showing that what is the progress by for in terms of the usage of the energy, per capita usage of the energy of India. So by this curve, it shows very encouraging that we are going in that way. That is the per capita usage. But if we compare with few of the global countries, not all of them, but I've just tried to match up with few of the very developed countries as well as few of our developed neighbors. So neighbor countries. So you can see that they there the India is not in that much of progressing line. That means India, in contrast to the other countries with the graph shown or the curve shown, it shows that we are way lag behind with the progress. Though we are comparatively better each of year with our own status, but in part of the other countries, we are lagging behind much of it. So next, I will just show you about the per capita energy consumption overall throughout the globe. If you can see this bar with the color codes, they are marked from the lowest value with the lightest color and the highest value with the deepest color. So few of this belt, this portion, you can see that highest accumulation of dark portion has been there. Here also some Middle East portion of the Asian continent is also there. Here there is a portion where there are much higher energy consumption available in the range of around 50,000 kilowatt hour. And India's portion is in this range, around 5,000 to 10,000 range of the per capita usage. So we need to boost up that part also, because that gives a platform in the global structure. Okay, this is the data up till 2019. Okay, this was the data about the Indian population access to electricity. That means how much of the Indian population they access the electricity progressing from last three decades, from 1990 onwards. So you can see, no doubt we are increasing the percentage of people who are with electricity. The blue lines are people with access to electricity, and green line are the people without access to the electricity. So no doubt we are diminishing the percentage of people who are not having the access to electricity, but also the numbers. Because one thing is that with the increase of population, no doubt we may increase the percentage, but it would have been disheartening if the number of people are also not decreasing. But that is very encouraging over here, is that with each year onwards, the government has been trying with various schemes, and they have been trying to make the people have the access to electricity for easy access. And I hope that with the recent developments and few of the schemes which have been delivered, it will be available to all the household in the near future. Okay, so from long back onwards, the governments have been seeing these things, and it is in the progress path itself. Okay, so now I'll come into the solar energy. What are the technologies available, developments, few of them we have seen up, and also we'll also see the sustainability. We'll question out it about its sustainability with the data as of now, and also with the prospect by which it is developing. Okay, so this was just to give an idea about that, what is the cost reduction on the production of solar energy and how they have been using it. So in terms of the solar photovoltaic, the cost has been reduced very huge range. That means since 2009 and up till 2019, this data which has been taken from, so it has been seen that the decline in the cost of the production of solar energy using the solar photovoltaic cell, the cost has been reduced by 90%. So obviously the power will be much economical as compared to the previous time. Okay, so that has been told that over that time, global solar energy production has grown more than tenfold. That means if the cost has been reducing, obviously the production will be in the higher range. So it gives an indication that this technology is obviously sustainable. Otherwise, the technology would have not been a successful one with this long run of decades or two decades. You cannot find that cost reducing, usage increasing, as well as, how can I say usage increasing? The next portion has been given that it was 0.01% of the total world electricity production up till 2008, which was been utilized from solar energy. And now in 2018, it has seen that 2% of the global energy, of electrical global energy, is being supplied by the solar power. So obviously there has been a tremendous increase in the energy usage of with the technology of solar. So by 2040, it has been expected that around 20% of the world's electricity will be powered by solar. And few of the countries, I think, I could not remember the name, few countries have totally cut off their conventional power plants, the production from the conventional power plants, coal-based, and have shifted into the majority of from the renewable energy sources, let it be wind, let it be solar. Okay, so renewable energy as a whole has are getting that prospect. But if you see the global structure or the pattern, that solar energy is wherever there is abundance in the solar energy, they are going through. But in Indian context, we are not so much concentrating with the other portions, because no doubt technology can be harnessed, but the availability of that source is not so much spread enough in the whole nation as compared to the solar energy in terms of the renewable energy, except the hydroelectricity. So this is the global installed capacity of solar energy up till 2016. So this also gives an indication that if it would have been not a sustainable technology, so obviously you could not have gone from around, I can say 10,000 of production near about 2008-09 to around to your 3 lakh megawatt, or I can say 300 gigawatt of power from solar energy, okay, that globally. And for India, and I've just listed out that value, that in Indian context, you can see that up till now, up till 2020, 37 gigawatt has been incorporated or installed with the solar energy, and a few more projects up till I think around the 13 gigawatt of projects are in line, which will be commissioned within a year or two. Okay, so you can expect within 2 more years we are going with the solar energy, though the target was 100 gigawatt, if not that much also, but we will be achieving much of that, near about that value. But what is interesting is that this solar energy has contributed around 10% of the total installed capacity of the nation as of now. And the total renewable energy, it is taking a quarter part of the total installed capacity. That means 1/4 of the total installed capacity for electrical energy usage is being supported with the renewable energy. So this is an encouraging point, and this technology has been going up in this scale. Okay. So this was the electricity production from renewables, from all the sources, including the hydropower, the wind and everything, up till 2014-15. There it can show you the range up till what much contribution it has been going. So up till 2014, you can see India was in the range near to 10. Okay, and now up till 2020, we can see we have surpassed 25 also. Okay, so that has been a great boom, that within this last decade, or I can say half a decade, the exponential rise with the use of renewables and specifically with the solar. So technology, if I say, the solar technology as of now has been taken up with these two types, that is solar photovoltaic using the photovoltaic cell. I will not go details with the photovoltaic, because the next topic I can see the speaker is will be delivering specifically on this part. And this is a known source from many time onwards, whoever are in touch with the solar energy, this photovoltaic cells, usage of photovoltaic cells and the production has been in touch, and progress has been going through. More of the production in India is with this solar photovoltaic. Okay, so with this, they are dependent on these color codes and how all these things are. You can just go, these are the very basic things. I've just shown you with the idea to show that they can be a rooftop for a household purpose also, for just, you can say, any of the offices and these all things can also take up that project. And this is for large scale production for big solar farms, where we can put an array of many modules and we can produce then power in terms of megawatts. Okay, so they have been in practice in India also. Now I come to the concentrated solar power. What exactly this topic is, in short, it is also called the solar thermal power. Why this is called solar thermal is that if you just keep out the solar, it is nothing but a traditional thermal power. What happens is that we generate there in thermal power plant for electrical background, I can say, the thermal power plant, what we do is that we have the boiler where we heat up the source with burning the fuel source, and then that it be coal, that it be natural gas, that it be oil, not oil exactly utilized, but natural gas and coal majorly it has been utilized. So those have been burned and the boiler has been heated up, and then the process with the steam turbine, it has been taken through. So this heat energy, what we do is that we don't burn any fossil fuels. Rather, we take the heating power of the sun, the solar energy's heating power, we concentrate it somewhere and we heat up that portion. So heating has been done, next thermal process has been taken care of with the same technology. So this concentrated solar power is a technology which produces electricity by concentrating solar energy in a single focal point. Let it be a different types of focal point, we will see, we can categorize those part. So this concentrated energy is then used to heat up fluid, produce steam and activate turbines that produce electricity. So only heating purpose is being utilized with the help of heat energy of solar or sun. And the rest portion is nothing but the same steam production and the processing with the prime mover turbine. Okay, and then with the help of alternator, we can produce the electricity. So here's few of the applications. I'm just keeping it out because these are been readily available. I have also shared my slides. You can go through where are these can be utilized. So I'll just concentrate on the CSP technology and few of the practices in diagrammatic way I will show. So if I want to segregate this concentrating solar technology, these types, they can be segregated with the types by which the collectors we use, or after the collection, that means the heat energy which we absorb, basing on the different collectors, what type of, what amount of heat energy that it consumes or it absorbs, based on that also we can categorize. So there can be category on the types of collectors, as well as it can be in another way, the type, the amount of heat energy it can absorb. So you can see with the low temperature near about less than or near about 100 degrees centigrade, it has been categorized low temperature. So generally we don't use this technology for electricity production because the temperature is not up to that level. That means the electricity can be produced with the help of prime mover. Next is the topic for medium temperature, where you can see the range of the temperature is coming up till near about 400 degrees centigrade. So this collectors which have been named, that is the parabolic trough or the Fresnel collectors, these are utilized at present for electricity production. It can be utilized because there is a range of 400 degrees centigrade of temperature. And if you want to go for higher end of the high temperature type, there are central towers and parabolic dish, this technology with the collecting portion. So with these two, there is a huge range of temperature gained, and we can utilize those also. Both are in practice in few of the other countries. Okay, so you can see that based on the previous one was about the category in terms of temperature range, and now we'll be categorizing in terms of the collectors. Collectors, you can, if you don't understand anything else also, you can just see that if I put a water filled bag in direct sunlight, after some time obviously, or a bottle of water, if you keep in sunlight, you will see that that water gets heated up. So obviously that is also a collector. A bottle of water kept in sunlight, it's a collector. So any form by which the heat energy has been absorbed or it has been collected, it is, can be a collector. But what we do is that we have specifically tried out with different types of collectors by which either it can absorb on its own or it can reflect those heat energy to a particular point where it will be absorbed in some other fluid sources. Okay, so there may be reflectors and then a collection, or it can be a direct absorbing that same portion on its own. While we go with discuss with the different types, we will be more clear about it. So by definition, what is it called? That a device designed to absorb incident solar radiation and to transfer the energy, that is the heat energy of a fluid passing in contact with it. So this heat energy has been transferred to that fluid which is passing through that portion. Okay, so usually liquid or air, that fluid can be. So based on the different structures or the way they concentrate the solar energy, the heat energy which has been falling on them, based on that, it has been categorized. The first one is non-concentrating and the types name are the different collectors names are flat plate collectors and evacuated tube collectors. This evacuated tube collector is nothing an advanced portion of the flat plate collector. So these are non-concentrating solar collectors. The next is about the concentrating. This concentrating means they are concentrating the solar energy, that heat which falls upon them, they concentrate into a particular focal part, that is focus type, or it may be a non-focus type. Okay, so out of this non-focus type, it is just the modified flat plate collector which we have seen in the previous part, and this is the focus type. It can be a line focus, it can be a point focus. That means by pictorial diagram you can understand that it will be in a series of lines where the focus will be portioned, and it will be a pinpoint where one single focal point will be there. Okay, so these collectors, they can be analyzed or they can be distributed with in terms of these three parts, that how much efficiency, that means what amount of heat energy has been falling onto that collectors, and how much amount of heat energy that can be transferred heat can be transferred through that collector. So they give their collector efficiency, concentration ratio, what is the size of the absorber area and what is the size of the collector area. Depending on that, the concentration ratio has also been termed up. Temperature range, we have seen that depending on the temperature range, we have categorized earlier itself. But they give that the what is the performance indices of different types of collectors. Okay, so this is the flat plate collector. These are generally utilized, as you can remember, these flat plate collectors, these are of the low temperature range, that is of the range of 100 degree centigrade. So they are not utilized for energy production, for electricity energy production. Rather, they are utilized for other energy utilization, like heating of water or some other small household purposes, mostly in the cold areas or in some of the institutional part, or maybe it in the hotels or somewhere like that. Okay, for large scale purposes, so they are being utilized. So I'm just skipping this portion as of now, because why we are mostly concentrated about the electricity production from the concentrated solar power. Okay, these are the structures. In basic, I can say that with this path, where we can, you can see that this portion is all joining. We pass the fluid where this blackened portion in the background is available. So when the sun rays fall, they absorb, the heat has been absorbed, and that has been transferred to the pipes running through the absorber. Okay, and then it has been passed through. So evacuated tube collector, what exactly is that? It was just an advanced, or you can say, what is that? The flat plate collectors, some modification has been done, and that has been given over here with the evacuated tube collectors. So this is that same flat plate collectors which has been utilized for solar air heating. This has also been utilized in colder regions, or you can find it in some of the hotels in some of the regions. Okay, this is your water heating of the your solar swimming pools. This is also not exactly utilized in general trend, but it can be done. What are the applications I've shown? So let me come on to the parabolic trough. So this is the part where it come in the second topic or the second category, that is the medium temperature range near about of 400 degrees centigrade within that range. So this diagram is clearly showing you that this is the parabolic trough, that curved structure where they can be tracked. That means they can be moved up and down, and it will be moved such, it will be moved such that the sun rays which are falling, as you can see in the diagram, they will be pointing it into this line focus. That is, this is the line focus category of the solar collectors, where the solar rays are falling and they have been concentrated into this single line focal point. Okay, so this is the way it has been done. So what is next? I will just show you. If this type of whole parabolic troughs, there are several parabolic troughs, they are kept in the whole field or solar farm, they will collect heat from each of these portion, and they will be going into, with the help of some your fluids which has been passing through, that can be concentrated, and again it can be processed, which will be given into this boiler. So after this boiler has been available with that heat fluid, the water or the other fluids which has been given onto this boiler, that absorb the heat energy, and the heat transfer has been taken care in this boiler. And the next process is the same way the conventional steam turbine works. That is, when you pass on to the steam into this steam turbine, this prime mover rotates, and that is connected with the alternator, which produces the electricity. Okay, and the further cooling and the condensing process, as in the other thermal process also done, this has been same. But the only thing is that the heating up of the boiler is not done here. The heat has been provided through a fluid with the help of these collectors. So this was the tracking which I was saying. In generally, we have got single axis tracking. This tracking is, this is the axis where it will move on to track the movement of the sun. And here, if few portion, it can be a dual axis. But in general, for large farms, we don't go for dual axis. It will be costly enough, and it is also much complex for maintaining that. So what we do is that we generally have the single axis rotation of the parabolic drum. So this is the Stirling solar dish. So this type of dish, this is the last one of the category, where what we have told is that it is having the range of more than 400 degrees centigrade. And what is the means, what I can say, the most influential point about this Stirling solar dish is that this portion where it has been kept as a single focal point, the sun rays have been focused, and this whole one setup individually is capable of generating near about 25 megawatt of that structure. If I'm not wrong, 25 or 5 megawatt. I may be wrong enough with the values, because most of the recent one are the higher nature, but I remember it is either of 5 megawatt or of 25 megawatt, okay, each of the solar dish. Because enormous, sorry. Sorry. Because enormous amount of energy has been produced with this large dish structure, which has been having a common focal point where it focuses. And this is the Stirling engine, which produces electricity and has been carried through. So you can have a large farms also with an individual structure also, if it is for an industrial purpose, or maybe for any of the office of the high power requirement nature, they can also have that structure available. But the location of that place should have that abundant amount of solar energy, heat energy available. Okay, so the one of the other point of that high temperature solar collectors, so this was the central tower. So the structure can show you there are various reflecting plates positioned. Okay, that can be a tracking one, a single tracking type, or it may be a fixed one. So generally they are kept with a single tracking, such that the common focal point can be concentrated. I will show next diagram, which will be more clear. Here you can see these heliostates, these are called, or the reflectors, they are being positioned as such that they will reflect into this portion. Okay, so when this it reflects the heat energy to that portion, there is a tank cap which gets heated up from all the heat source concentrated to a common point, and that heat has been transferred, and it has been given into the bottom of this tower where the alternator has been put, the steam turbine has been put. So the heat energy goes and makes the prime mover work on. So after that, it is the next process goes on with the conventional thermal station, which is coming up, which is been shown up at the earlier time. This is the overall diagram, how it goes through. This is the heliostate, which I have told. You can have a tracking system. When the sunlight falls, it will be always concentrating to this common focal point. And there, this water or any of the fluids which has been given, which absorbs the heat, and the steam has been produced, which has been given to the turbine. And with the help of generator, the electricity has been produced and it is given through. So this technology, the concentrated solar power technology, actually this technology has been in some of the recent times, not too earlier enough. It was been utilized for electricity production, but it has been available in the recent times. And I've just collected one data as of this. In July 2020, Tulane University of New Orleans, they have developed one hybrid solar energy converter, okay, with an efficiency of around nearly about 40%. and they can utilize the steam which has been produced after it has been processed in the primer. They can utilize this steam for other purpose also. Other purpose in the sense wherever the heat energy has been required. So this heat energy after the processing in the turbine, they utilize it for that purpose, and during this process in the turbine, they produce the electricity. So this has been in progress in the recent times. And in India, we don't have much of the production with the help of this technology, but it has gained its momentum because it has started with near about, I think, 2015-16 with a scale of around 50 to 53 megawatt was being installed at that time, 2016 onwards. And though it has not increased much of it, but it is getting scope of that part, because initially India was been concentrating with the solar power, and that has increased much of its value. But this technology is a newer technology which can have from one farm, it can have much power which is required for the electricity of any country. Okay, so this technology is been in upscale, and in global structure, I think 2019 it has contributed near about 7 to 8 gigawatt of power has been installed with this technology. Okay. So this is just an few of the advantages or disadvantages, I can say. So not disadvantages, that additional benefits I can say with concentrated solar power technology is that we have got heat storage option. That means if you see over here in this technology, that is central tower, this tower, when this heat has been provided and the water or the any fluid where the heat transfer is to be done, if it has been given over here, so if we keep the heat intact over there after it has been absorbed by this heat absorber, it will be kept over there, and this the fluid will not be passed through. So that means the heat will be kept on that your boiler, and it may be utilized in some other time. Other time I can say is that with a delay of few hours. So what happens is that if you have got abundant solar energy and in the daytime you can use other technologies, or there can be a multiple generation plants where few plants can be utilized for giving the present load demand, and this type of heat energy can be stored, which can be utilized at a later time when the sun energy is not been available. So this is a very great boon to us that this can store the heat energy without additional requirement. Only thing is that we need to see that when the heat has been absorbed, the the leakage of the heat should not be done. So that type of option should be available with that part. So heat energy option is an storage option is a great option with this technology, where in solar photovoltaic, what happens if we need to store that with the battery or some other sources? So there is a huge burden of economics in that part. But here it is not that much of burden of the economy as compared to the others. So you can utilize it in other time when the sun energy is not there. So there is a cogeneration, obviously that process heat generation can be done, which has been, as I told you, in Tulane University, New Orleans, it has been going in progress and it has been successfully done. Okay, so that is an hybrid option, good for high temperature regions. It depends upon locations where it need to be utilized. So the concentration of the solar insolation where it is high enough, you can go with that. Predictable and reliable power, predictable in the sense that we have got the forecasted data of the solar energy, so we can know how much production we can do in a sum of minimal ranges of changing, we can have that prediction. Okay, and water desalination along with that is the cogeneration and the hybrid option which I am saying that can be there. Other benefits, obviously the carbon emission reduction, because we all know, I haven't going on with this discussion, because we all know that this solar energy and the technology utilized with it, it has got very less effect on the environment. So obviously that is still prevailing. No fuel or its transport cost, obviously once the setup has been done, that has not been there. Energy security, obviously, as I have told, the main one of the main motto of the National Solar Mission was also about the energy security, which it can also give through it. And high share of local contents, that means the local employability as well as the other requirements also increases employment generation. So these are many of the benefits. So I tried to cope up with this with the topics, which was the main purpose of this STTP, was that what are the developments or recent works going on with the technologies, especially with the sustainable green energy technology. So this is one of the technology. It was just an I can say I was making an awareness of this with this technology availability, though it is much less used as at present in our nation, but it has got a long run to go because it can give huge amount of power productions with the different types of collectors which we have seen. So in coming time, it has got a market as well as for the entrepreneurs also, there is much options for those things. Okay. So with this, I want to conclude out my topic or my discussion. And as you can see in this last slide, what has been given is that we have got abundance amount of solar energy. We only just need to tap that potential. Okay. And government is helping out with subsidy and subsidized schemes available. It has been starting in the initial part of the 2010, and many of them have utilized those subsidies, the educational institution, the organization, the industrial sectors, everyone were been given with the scheme. And nowadays it has been utilized and it has been in prevailing structures. So we need to tap this potential and make our earth more eco-friendly, as well as also make the grid more smart enough with this type of technology. So I've just shared my email ID also. If anyone wants to have any discussion later, we can go on through. There I complete my presentation and I open up for any of the questions if it has been required.
Participants, you can pose the questions. Any questions from the participants?
Okay, as I can understand that this was a very basic idea given of the concentrated solar power. So, and this technology is not in that much of used structure in our nation. So most of them might not be having any much questions about it, about its sustainability, about its processes. But the main target of this was that it should come with the topic of the program. So with this program, if I can just imbibe that information and the knowledge to all of them, they can readily go into these structures and come up with the new ideas, because firstly the research goes on, then only the implementation comes into the society. So any questions, if it is required with the research ideas also, that can be easily available. I have worked on with this structure for solar thermal process for grid connected power system, and they have been readily accepted in global pattern. So anyways, if we don't have any question as of now, you can put up the questions into my email ID, which I have also shared. Okay, organizer, is there anything else?
Dear participants, if you have any questions or any queries related to this topic, just you unmute your video and directly ask the question also, it's acceptable. Wait for 2 or 3 minutes. If you have any queries related to the topic or any other related issues, also just to discuss with the sir. Rama madam.
Yes, sir.
But if participant not post the queries in the chat box, means say what of thanks to sir, madam.
Okay, sir. As of now, there are no questions in the chat box. Okay, sir. So thank you, sir, for your wonderful session.
I'm just interrupting. I have got one question in the chat box.
Okay, sir. Now we got, sir.
Yeah, yeah. There it's been asked that how steam is generated with solar power. I think more temperature is required to generate steam. See, the temperature which has been absorbed, that is in the scale of 400 or 400 degrees centigrade or more, steam can be generated any temperature above 100 degrees centigrade. It depends upon how much amount we require, but steam can be generated above 100 degrees centigrade, which has been readily available from the second category of the medium temperatures, parabolic trough or Fresnel collectors. They have been applicable. And if you go with the central tower, or I can say that solar Stirling, distirling, so that technology also gives you abundant amount of heat energy that targets near about 800 degrees centigrade also with the Stirling engine as well as the solar tower. So with that, as well as the medium category up till 400 degree, it is sufficient to generate steam. Then I can see another question of scope of reliability in solar power in research point of view, sir. Scope of reliability in solar power. I didn't get the question exactly in research point of view. The question who has posed, if he or she is asking, is that in the solar power, reliability, the scope of reliability in solar power and research point of view. I'm not getting exactly the question. Anyways, what I think the question is referring, that means in reliability in solar power, when you do the research on these topics. So I can find out that since it is a sustainable one and it is going through with the practical analysis, not only simulation works, but also the practical analysis has been going through. So obviously, you don't have to worry about the reliability of this topic in part of the research. So that was my point of understanding by the question. I don't get the question in full. Okay, I don't find any more question regarding to this. Okay, organizer, it's up to you.
Madam Rama, madam.
Thank you, sir, for your wonderful session, and we learned a lot. Thank you so much for sharing your time and experiences with us. We are all agreed that your lecture was the most interesting we had this year, and we are looking forward to have more sessions from you, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. Then, so
sir, thank you, sir.
Can leave this session as of
yes,
now.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Astur Rahman.